सर कॉपी में नहीं चाहिए तो सर
आता फक्त माउस ने क्लिक करायचं
ओके इंट्रोडक्शन तर करचा
I welcome you all to the Arts Commerce Science College Palus for my presentation on photochemistry. The principal of our college, Dr. R. S. Salunkhe sir, IQSE coordinator of our college, Dr. P. M. Patil sir, head of Department of Zoology, Dr. S. S. Patil sir, Abhijit Ghadge sir, our technician team, Sandeep Patil sir, Prakash Nikam sir, D.T. Kumbhar sir, all teaching staff and non-teaching staff, I welcomes you all for my lecture on photochemistry. I am Sanjeevani Narayan Potpode from Department of Chemistry, Arts, Commerce and Science College, Palus, District, Sangli. Here, I would like to discuss with you what is photochemistry. Photochemistry in everyday life, in particularly in nature, medicine and in industry. All of you know, in nature, lot of reactions are taking place and in this, photosynthesis is the major one, our fission, it is the another one, then phototropism, that is the orientation of plants towards the direction of sunlight and the formation of ozone layer. These are the few examples that occur in nature. Then in the medicine, the treatment of jaundice of newborn babies. Then photodynamic therapy, that is the radiotherapy which is used for the cancer treatment. And in industry, I would like to highlight the few examples. The first one regarding the photography, then photopolymerization and degradation of polymers, then photocopying, photochromism, that is used in the sunglasses. Here, I would like to discuss with introductory part of the photochemistry, then types of chemical reactions, absorption of light, laws of photochemistry. There are four laws of photochemistry. I would discuss one by one. Then what is the quantum yield or quantum efficiency, then luminescence, and the major focus of my presentation, it is on the fluorescence and phosphorescence. Here, the brief history of fluorescence is in 1980s. The single molecule detection, it is done with the help of fluorescence correlation spectroscopy, and it is becoming almost routine work at that time. Then afterwards, the new class of probes have been appeared, such as semiconductor nanoparticles, or it is also called as quantum dots, and genetically engineered green fluorescence probes, and it is now becoming possible to control the excited states of fluorophores rather than relying only on spontaneous emission. These developments are changing the paradigm of fluorescence. And this topic, it is of my own interest, so I would like to discuss with you. As already I have told you that in nature, photosynthesis, fission, and the phototropism takes place. You know, in the human body, eyes are the organs of visual system, and the structure and function of the eyes are complex. Each eye constantly adjusts the amount of light it lets in, focuses on the objects near and far, and produces images. That means our eyes, they acts as a digital camera, and without light we are not able to see any matter or any object around us. So our eye, it is very important, and the photo, it is also very important. Here I will explain you the photochemistry. It mainly deals with the study of chemical reactions caused by absorption of light radiations in the visible and UV region. And that UV and visible region has the wavelength in between 200 nanometers to 800 nanometers. Here the electromagnetic spectrum, it consists of the light having different wavelengths, and it is arranged in either increasing wavelength or decreasing frequencies. Here the gamma rays of the electromagnetic spectrum, they have 0.01 nanometer wavelength, X-rays having 1 nanometer wavelength, UV having 200 wavelength up to 200, and the visible spectrum, it has the wavelength in between 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer. And IR microwaves, then radio waves, they have their particular wavelength, and there is an inverse proportion in between the wavelength and energy. The less wavelength or lower wavelength, they have higher energy, and maximum wavelength or larger wavelength, these radiations have lower wavelength. Here to explain this, I would like to share with you the UV light having 200 nanometer wavelength, it has energy 604 kilojoule per mole. Then visible radiation having wavelength 400 nanometer, it has energy 302 kilojoule per mole. And infrared radiation having 800 nanometer wavelength, having energy, it is 151 kilojoule per mole. Then something regarding photochemical reactions. A photochemistry, it is the branch of physical chemistry, and it mainly deals with the study of rates and mechanisms of the chemical reactions which accompanied by the absorption of light or photons of the electromagnetic radiation. And as you are well aware of, the photosynthesis is the best example of the photochemical reaction. Here photosynthesis of HCl gas, it is also the another example of photochemical reaction, in which in presence of light, hydrogen gas molecules and chlorine gas molecules, they absorb photons and produces twice of HCl gas. Then another example of photosynthesis, it is the with the help of CO2 and water, in presence of light, chlorophyll pigments, they converts the light energy into carbohydrates, glucose and oxygen. This is the well-known example of photochemical reaction. And also in the human body, the formation of vitamin D, it is also takes place with the exposure of sunlight. In short, the reactions which are caused by heat and in absence of light are called as thermal or dark reactions, and the reactions which takes place only when the substituent or substances absorbs the visible and ultraviolet radiations, then and then chemical changes takes place. These reactions are called as photochemical reactions. Then the certain distinguishing points between photochemical and thermochemical reactions. Here, as already we are all aware of, the photochemical reaction involves the absorption of light, and thermochemical reactions, these reactions involve the absorption or evolution of light, heat, sorry. The presence of light is the primary requirement for reactions to take place in case of photochemical reactions, and thermochemical reactions or dark reactions, they can take place without light, in absence of light also. Then the temperature has very little effect on photochemical reactions, while temperature has a significant effect on the rate of thermochemical reaction. And the major distinguishing point in between photochemical and thermochemical reactions are the free energy of photochemical spontaneous reactions. It is always positive because the energy absorbed by the substance, it get converted into free energy of the products. So the free energy of photochemical reactions increases, and the free energy of dark reactions or ordinary reactions, it is always decreases. That means the spontaneous reactions, they occurs with decrease in energy or accompanied in decrease in energy, loss of free energy. And photochemical reactions are highly selective. That means the only photochemical active substances, they absorb the radiations. The photochemically inactive substances, they do not absorb that light reaction, and so that the photochemical reaction does not takes place. And in case of thermochemical reactions, the activation is not selective in nature. These are the certain distinguishing points between thermochemical reactions and photochemical reactions. To summarize once again, the difference between photochemical and thermochemical reactions. Here, photochemical reactions, they takes place, they occurs due to the absorption of light radiation. Temperature has very significant or very less effect. Free energy of photochemical reactions increases, and photochemical reactions are highly selective in nature, while the thermochemical reactions, they takes place with the absorption or evolution of heat. They can take place in dark also. Temperature has a significant effect on the rate of thermochemical reaction, and all the thermochemical reactions accompanied with loss in free energy, or free energy is always negative. And in case of thermochemical reactions, activation is not selective in nature. Then I will discuss with you the laws of photochemistry. Here, the first law of photochemistry, it is the Grotthus-Draper law, and the statement of this law is only the light which is absorbed by a molecule can be effective in producing a photochemical change in a molecule. The significance of this law, here the whole radiations that are absorbed, it is not necessary to produce a photochemical change. Only those radiations which are absorbed are effective in producing the chemical change. It is not necessary to have a chemical reaction with the absorption of light. It depends on whether that molecule is photochemically active or inactive. And the second law of photochemistry, it is also called as the law of photochemical equivalence, and it is investigated by the scientists Stark and Einstein's law, and it states that for each photon of light absorbed by a chemical system, only one molecule is activated for a photochemical reaction. The energy absorbed by one mole of the reacting molecules is given by the equation E, it is equal to N H nu, where E, it is called as energy, one Einstein energy, where N is the Avogadro number and H Planck's constant having value 6.625 × 10⁻³⁴ joule second. Nu is the frequency of radiation, that is nu, it is equal to C by lambda, where C, it is the velocity of light, and lambda, it is the wavelength of radiation absorbed. Then the photochemistry, it deals with the absorption of light. Here the Grotthus-Draper law, it states that only light which is absorbed by a system can cause a chemical change. And Stark-Einstein's law, one quantum of light is absorbed, one quantum of light absorbed per molecule, then and then a chemical reaction takes place. This law, it is also called as the law of photochemical equivalence, or one molecule, one photon. In short, it is, then the Lambert-Beer's law. Here in the diagram, at the center there is a cuvette, that means a sample holder, and in which we have taken a solution of a homogeneous solution. Then the incident radiation, it has intensity suppose I0, and when it transmits through the absorbing medium, the intensity of the incident radiation, it decreases, and it is shown in the diagram. Here the Lambert's law, it states that when a monochromatic or a heterogeneous light incident on a absorbing medium, then the rate of decrease of intensity of incident radiation, it is proportional to the thickness of the absorbing medium. It is shown in the diagram. Intensity is less in when it transmits through that particular absorption thickness. And T, it is the transmittance, and it is the nothing but the fraction of incident light transmitted through the absorbing medium. It is given by the ratio of intensity I divided by I0. That means when the light transmits through absorbing medium, at that intensity is I, and before entering into the absorbing medium intensity, it is I0. And the ratio I divided by I0, it is equal to transmittance. Then the reciprocal of a transmittance, it is called as opacity. That means opacity, it is equal to I0 divided by I, and the log of opacity, it is called as absorbance or optical density. In short, optical density A or D, it is equal to log of I0 by I. Then the extent of photochemical reaction, at what extent the photochemical reaction takes place, it is explained with the help of quantum yield, and it is expressed with the help of notation phi. The number of molecules reacting per quantum of energy absorbed to the number of quanta of light absorbed in the same time, or phi, it is also equal to number of molecule reacting in a given time divided by number of Einsteins of light absorbed in the same time. This is the quantum yield. Then the experimental determination of quantum yield. Here, the determination of number of moles reacted, and second, determination of number of Einsteins absorbed will be done with the help of this instrument. And this instrument, the major parts of this instrument, they consist of light source, then monochromator, reaction cell and detector. In UFI region, the light source is mercury lamp, while in the visible region, the source of light, it is the tungsten light. And sunlight also we can use as a source of light. Then there are collimating lens, then they passes through the monochromator. Monochromator, it is also called as a filter. It absorbs the wavelengths, other wavelengths that are not needed, and only it transmits the wavelength of certain energy, and that is absorbed in the sample. And at what extent of light is absorbed, it is detected with the help of detector. This is the schematic representation of photoelectric photocell. Then I would like to explain you the phenomenon of fluorescence and phosphorescence in terms of excitation of electrons. Here at ground state level, all the electrons, they are paired. That means two electrons, they have one electron, it has a spin in upward direction, another electron, it has spin in a downward direction. And the total spin of this, it is equal to 0 plus 1 half plus minus 1 half, it is equal to 0. And the spin multiplicity, it is calculated by the formula here, 2s plus 1. Spin multiplicity rule, it is equal to 2s plus 1, where s, it is the total spin. Then in the ground state, when the two electrons, they have paired spin, that their total spin, it becomes equal to 0, and s, it is equal to total spin, it becomes equal to 1. So that state we call as a singlet ground state or s0 state. And when that molecule, it is irradiated with the photon, it absorbs the light radiation, it due to absorption of light radiation, one of the electron, it is jumped from lower energy state to the higher energy state. And in the excited state, suppose that electron has a anti-parallel spin. That means in the ground state, first electron, it has upward direction spin, and in excited state, the second electron, it has downward spin. Then again the sum of these two, total spin equal to 0 and spin multiplicity equal to 1 by using the formula 2s plus 1. As s equal to 0, 2s becomes 0 plus 1. Therefore, this state, it is called as singlet excited state, and we call it as a S1. Here, a pair of electron with opposite spins but in a different orbital, we get singlet excited state. If again due to absorption of excess energy, then this electron, it jumps to higher level, and we get singlet S2 state or singlet S3 state, depending on the amount of energy absorption. These states are called singlet excited states as S1, S2, S3. Then again, if the due to absorption of heat or photon, the one electron is at ground state and another electron, it is at higher energy level or excited state, and its spin, it is in a upward direction. That means two electrons, they have a parallel spins but in a different orbitals. Here the total spin of this state, it is equal to 1, and spin multiplicity, it becomes equal to 3. Such states are called as triplet excited states. And remember that in a triplet excited state, pair of electrons with parallel spins but in a different orbitals. That spin multiplicity equal to 3. These states are called as triplet excited states. Again, depending on the energy absorption, extent of energy absorption, we have T1 state, T2 state and T3 state. Then the excited species can return to the ground state by losing all of its excess energy by any one of the path. It is shown in the Jablonski diagram. This is the Jablonski diagram. Here S0 states means singlet ground state. This one is the singlet excited first state and this is the singlet excited second state. The molecules at a singlet ground state, they absorbs energy and they get transferred from ground state to higher energy level at a singlet S1 and immediately they returns back. This phenomenon, it is called as fluorescence phenomenon. Here the lifespan of the excited molecule, it is very less, it is in the order of 10 raised to minus 8 seconds. Within this very short time, the fluorescence occurs. Fluorescence means the absorbed energy, it is re-emitted in the form of radiation. This phenomenon is called as fluorescence. And when the molecule at singlet state, it comes to the triplet state by the process, non-radiative process, that process is called as inter-system crossing. And then it is that molecule comes at triplet state, triplet first, and it re-emits the absorbed radiation. That phenomenon, it is called as phosphorescence. Here the phenomenon of phosphorescence, it is also called as delayed fluorescence. Then non-radiative transition, it is also called as internal conversion. This is the again Jablonski diagram. In it depicts the phenomenon of fluorescence, process of absorption, non-radiative transition, that is internal conversion, then inter-system crossing, absorption process. Then I would like to explain here, when the molecule absorbs energy, it takes place at a higher energy level and it returns back to the lower energy level. This phenomenon, it is called as fluorescence and it is takes place in a very short time. Returns back to the singlet state. And this is the fluorescence takes place in a nanosecond. The term fluorescence, it is coined in 1853 by the scientist Stokes and it is first observed in 1845 by the scientist J.F.W. Herschel and it is the experiment of, it consists of, here the solution of quinine, it is kept on a round bottom table and a wine glass containing wine, yellow glass, it is also kept in on a round table and the sunlight from the window of church, it is incident on this quinine solution, it passes through the wine glass and the superficial layer of this wine, it becomes a stellar blue color and it is observed by this scientist Herschel in 1845. This phenomenon, in 1853 it is coined by Stoke as a fluorescence. This is the experimental setup. The fluorescence is now a dominant methodology used extensively in biotechnology, flow cytometry, medical diagnostics, DNA sequencing, fluorescence forensics and genetic analysis. These are the few names where the fluorescence phenomenon is used. Here the flow cytometry, it consists of the flow of single cell through a laser beam, and cancerous cells are detected. A single cancerous cell, it is detected with the help of flow cytometry. Again, in forensic, the crime scenes, fingerprints are detected with the process of fluorescence. Here, the example of chemiluminescence, that is luminescence observed in a chemical reactions, or production of light without heat. These processes are called as luminescence. In this conical flask, we have luminol and peroxidase before adding H2O2. This beaker is kept in a dark, and when we add H2O2, the solution becomes bright blue colored, violet colored. This is the chemiluminescence. Then some examples of bioluminescence. Bioluminescence, the production of and emission of light in living organisms, it is called as bioluminescence. For example, certain mushrooms, then insects and some fishes, we observe bioluminescence. The best example here, it is the firefly. All of you are very well familiar with the firefly, and it is the chemiluminescence and also a bioluminescence. These are the certain examples of fluorescence and phosphorescence. Then something regarding the photosynthesis. Here, with the help of carbon dioxide, H2O and sunlight, green pigments, that means chlorophylls in the plants, they produces glucose and oxygen. Here in detail, photosynthesis, the process of photosynthesis that occurs with the help of chloroplast in plant cells to create food for the plant. Then chemical reaction which takes place in the photosynthesis, 6 molecules of H2O, they combines with 6 molecules of carbon dioxide with the help of chlorophyll and sunlight, and they produces 6 molecules of carbohydrate and 6 molecules of H2O. Then another example here, carbon cycle. Carbon moves from atmosphere to the plants, and from plants to the animals, and back to atmosphere. This is the carbon cycle. Then summary of photosynthesis, light energy absorbed by chlorophyll drives the reactions of photosynthesis that converts light energy to chemical energy to make organic compounds. CO2 and H2O used to produce glucose and oxygen gas. Then this is the carbon cycle once again. Then quenching of fluorescence. There are number of processes that lead to reduction in fluorescence intensity, and this reduction in fluorescence intensity, it is termed as quenching. These processes can occur during excited state lifetime. For example, collisional quenching, energy transfer, then charge transfer reactions or photochemical reaction. Here I would like to explain you how the collisional quenching takes place. In collisional quenching, when excited fluorophore experiences contact with an atom or molecule, that can facilitate non-radiative transition to the ground state. Common quenchers include O2, iodine molecule, CS+, and acrylidide. Here the acknowledgement, I have used this website for my preparation, and this is the very important textbook that I have referred, The Principles of Fluorescence Spectroscopy, 3rd edition by Joseph and Lakovich. Thank you. Once again, I would like to thank you, the principal of our college, Dr. Salunkhe sir, the technician team, they have given me this opportunity to represent my presentation. Thank you very much. Kiti vela zala?